idea what I'm talking about, and then you started preaching, and I still have no. No, I'm kidding. It's, well, that's just a chase, but boy, we ought to. The Bible, many times, the Bible talks about preachers making sense of the word,
right?
Making sense of what God is saying. And Micah is a prophet. God's called him. He's ministering in a very unique time. He's ministering, having a chance to minister to both north and southern kingdoms. The northern kingdoms, towards the beginning of Micah's kingdom, were still intact. But as Micah's ministry went on, the northern kingdom collapsed, and just the southern kingdom remained. And oftentimes, he's just preaching to the southern kingdom. And Micah chapter, there's a word that repeats itself a few times in the book of Micah. It's called here. The word is here. And he's saying, hey, listen up. Right? 2017, Philadelphia vernacular. Right. Hey, listen up. Pay attention. You know? And the prophet said here. And Micah chapter 4, he's kind of rolling through. Now, what they had just been told, the southern kingdom, is that they were going to be taken captive. Micah the prophet said, you're going to be going into captivity. Now, that's not a great bit of news. All right, it didn't happen yet, but they just saw the northern kingdom collapse. And so the southern kingdom, Israel, actually Judah, is getting ready to go through a tough time. Now, sometimes preachers have to communicate bad news. Sometimes you avoid the preacher because you know what he's going to tell you, because God's already told you. If the pastor's telling you, you've already heard it. All right, if the pastor's going to say something to you, he's going to rebuke you or challenge you. Can I just be honest with you? You've already heard it. He's only being sent because you've been saying no to the Holy Spirit of God that indwells you.
Right.
God's got the corner on correcting us and confronting us in our sin. Sometimes he has to send the human. And when the human comes, that's like strike two.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, sir.
And so we understand that God's telling these people they know they're wrong. They know they're going to go into captivity. And they're going to cry. In fact, they're in the middle of just this turmoil. Things are starting to fall apart around them. And how do they handle this crisis? They cry out. I know you're going to join me in standing, right? We read Micah chapter 4. The first couple times I came here, it like surprised me. People started standing, and I didn't ask them to. And so I thought, oh, there we go. Micah chapter 4, we'll read 32 verses, and then I'll, no, I'm kidding. We've got two verses. All right, Brother Paul will let you sit. He'll let you sit when you're singing. But maybe when I'm preaching, I'll let you sit for a little bit. We'll read two verses here, and then we'll pray. Micah 4, verses 8 and 9. O thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion, unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion. The kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. Look at verse 9. Now why dost thou cry aloud? Is there no king in thee? Is thy counselor perished? For pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. I love that last phrase. For pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. I've been in the labor delivery room two times with my wife. And the pains of delivery are severe.
Yeah.
All right? If you've never been there and they give you the option to stay in the waiting room, stay in the waiting room. My dad had to wait in the waiting room, and I wish they would have let me stay in the waiting room. I was in pain. Nothing was happening to me. Right? Some of the guys were just like, yeah, I'll get it. The wives are like, yeah, that's right. He ought to pay, you know? But boy, you talk about pain as severe as childbirth. Boy, it's real.
Yeah.
This crisis is real. We're going to look and see what this chapter says about dealing with crisis. Let's pray, okay? Father God, I thank you for the chance that I could be here, the strength you've given me to stand behind this pulpit. I thank you for the chance you have given me again to open your word, to share it, Lord. It really is the delight of my life to read and prepare and study and share and teach and disciple others. I thank you for that privilege. And Lord, I pray tonight that I would not take it for granted. May not this night go by without me acknowledging that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You're the giver of this word. And my teaching of it, Lord, pales in comparison to all that you have for us in it. Lord, I pray tonight that you take my mouth, take my thoughts, my mind. Lord, I pray that you would only give me that which you'd have me to share with these people. They're your people. You love them. Lord, you lead them through, bring them through, take them through, put them through trials. Lord, sometimes use crisis to manipulate us and move us to where you want us. Lord, I pray that we, your people, would not see every crisis as chastisement. May we not see every crisis as trial, but Lord, may we see that you are in control and that you use these things to blow us, direct us, move us. Many times, Lord, it's because we haven't heeded to your call. It's not, we haven't heeded to your instruction. Lord, I pray that you would still take this time and, of correction and move us to where you want us to be for your best glory, for your glory, for the King of Kings and for our best good. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. We've all been there, haven't we? We'll be there again the moment it feels like the bottom has dropped down.
Right.
You know, I look around the room and I know some of you. And I know some of the trials that you've had to face and some of the things you've been looking at. You know, when you're at a loss over what's happened or even what's about to happen. The prophet Micah is being used to foretell the upcoming captivity and deliverance of Judah and Babylon. His message struck fear into the hearer. While the captivity, though, was a coming reality and it caused them to cry, that is not the focus of this chapter. God's not piling on in Micah chapter 4. God's not saying it's all falling apart and I'm just going to keep adding on to the misery. This is a chapter of light. So let's look at this problem, this calamity, this crisis from God's perspective, shall we? So let's look at verse number 1, and we'll look at verses 1 to 4. We'll see our first point. But in the last days it shall come to pass that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established in the top of the mountains, and it shall be exalted above the hills, and the people shall flow unto it. Now before we move on to verse number 2, I want you to do something. If you mark your Bible, if you're one of those people that mark your Bible, I want you to do this. I want you to underline in the last days. Because this is going to show us something. That phrase is the key to understanding this first point. You might say, well, I don't really get it right now, but I want you to see something in a minute. But verse 2. And many nations shall come and shall say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he shall judge among many people and rebuke strong nations afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. But they shall sit every man under his vine, under his fig tree, and none shall make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken it. Now, if you are a serious Bible student, you realize that this is talking about a time in Israel's history. This is talking about the promise of God's millennial kingdom. This is a promise where there'll be peace. This is a promise where they'll have prosperity. They'll have rest from their labors and their wars. This is a prophetical promise. Now, what's it doing in the midst of the proclamation of God's judgment? What is this about? There were some bits of prophecy that have already been fulfilled in the book of Micah. But there's still yet some that have to still be fulfilled. You know what I think God's showing them? I think God's showing them that he's not finished with them. He's going to lead them into the correction, but he's not throwing them away.
Amen.
He's not getting rid of them. This first point is this. When we come to trials, when we come to crisis, we need to remember, point number one, the plan of God. God's got a plan. You know, I had a friend of mine, really good friend of mine, just had some things happen. One of his kids disappointed him and caused some shame to the family. You know, one of those moments. And I just called him and said, hey, brother, I love you. Can I do anything for you? I'm your friend. I'll remind you of that. I'm just your friend. And I said this, the sun will come out tomorrow. It's not the end of the world. But sometimes we need to remind it that it's not the end of the world.
Amen.
Israel was going to go into captivity. They were going to Babylon. See, I was marrying words there. Baptivity. Did you get that? Babylon, captivity. I should coin that.
Yeah.
Put that in the sword of the Lord. All right? Bible fires. I don't know where it's going. It's going nowhere, right? God's letting them know, listen, there's some things we need to deal with, but it's not the end of you.
Yeah. Right.
You know, there are things that maybe my children are in trouble, and I've had times where my son got in trouble and said, all right, get your stuff, we got to go. We're still going? Yeah. your life's not over because you messed up. It's not over. It's not over because I led you to this place. It's not over. Crisis is not the end of it. It's something that we come through. They were getting ready to lose their national identity. They were getting ready to lose their comfort, their homes. I mean, I wouldn't want to have to leave my home. I wouldn't want a foreign army to come pick me up and take me into captivity. I mean, that's not a... I mean, you talk about losing your home. I have a hard time. If you lose your wallet, it's the end of the world. Right? You got to go, what credit cards I got in there? Just to go to the DMV, that'll teach you to hold on to your wallet.
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm talking about, right? You're about ready to lose everything, and God's saying, but I'm not done with you. There's going to come a time. So they're here in history, and right over here, they're going to go into captivity. But God said, let me illustrate something for you here. I got plans for you that stretch all the way over here. This isn't the end of your story. Amen. This isn't the end of who you are. I've got a plan. I love it when God's making plans. I love it when he takes my brokenness. And most of the time, the brokenness of my life is my own doing.
Yeah.
I break me. Better than anyone else breaks me. I do. I wanted them to believe. I believe that God wanted them to understand that his plan for them continued through their dark stage. He saw beyond their now. You know, crisis draws our focus so that we can only see the now. Crisis prioritizes the past, it plagues the present, and it poisons our perspective of the future. All we can see is what's going on now. Some of us are in the now. We can't even see the now because we're so disappointed about the yesterday.
Yeah.
And the yesterday may have been actually yesterday, or it could have been a month ago, it could have been a year ago, it could have been 4 years ago. Something that happened, that's all we can think of. We can't move past it.
Right.
And God says, don't you understand? I've got big plans for you.
Yeah,
I'm not through with you. His son was still going to be born through that nation.
Right.
Jesus hadn't been born
yeah.
yet. Let me tell you something. The greatest thing that ever happened to this world is Jesus Christ.
Right.
Yeah, man.
Period, right? And that was still in their future.
Right.
Forget the millennium. That's just gravy.
Yeah.
Jesus being born, the Redeemer, the Messiah, was going to come from them. All that they ever hoped for, all that they ever wanted, it wasn't over. And some of us, when our dreams get crashed, when our dream job is taken, when the best boy ever turns out not to be the best boy ever.
Right.
You don't understand. Can I tell you, suicide says there's no plan.
Right.
Past this.
Yeah.
Whatever the... You see it last week on the news, that 12-year-old girl that committed suicide on a live feed?
Mm-hmm.
Facebook Live or whatever. She streamed it live on suicide. Did you see that 12-year-old girl? I see her walking through the woods, setting up. You see her hanging. In the background, you hear her mother calling her from the porch. Let me tell you something. I could not watch that. There's no way in the world I could watch that. But you know what you have to believe to take life? Your own? There's no more plan.
Yeah.
See, the worst lie the devil has for you is there's nothing left.
Right.
Yeah.
And he's telling us that lie.
Yeah.
People in this room have heard that lie. We believe that lie. I tell you, preachers are exempt.
Yeah, amen.
Preachers are not exempt. Let me tell you something. Monday for a preacher is like the worst day ever. It's like D-Day all over again.
Mm-hmm.
Why am I doing this? Why? That was a bad day. That was a bad message. That was a big mistake. The Babylonian captivity wouldn't be your end. I often take time to remind people, I'll remind you today, if you're in crisis, tomorrow's coming. Our sorrow will soon pass. Well, I don't think you know that. Well, okay, well, Psalm 30, verse 5 says, for his anger endureth but for a moment.
That's right.
And his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night. I love when the Bible uses the word but.
Amen.
Because if the Bible's true, right, you can't argue with the Bible, can you?
Nope.
I can't. You can't argue with the Bible. Are you going to argue with the Bible? You ever have an argument with the Bible and win?
No.
Never. And when the Bible says but, that settles it.
Yeah, amen.
But joy cometh in the morning.
That's right.
Some of you don't have joy because you don't let today end.
Yeah,
amen.
Yeah.
That's it. Go to stink in bed.
Yeah.
You know?
Preach.
You can't sleep, pray God. You said you'd give your beloved rest.
Yeah.
Amen.
Turn your Bible to Psalm 127. You can't sleep, troubles all around you. Turn your Bible to Psalm 127 and remind God what He's promised you.
That's it, amen.
Right.
I'll tell you what, I never have problems. I have a ton of problems. And that's just when I look in the mirror. You know what I'm saying? When I look at... No? He said no. He doesn't have a mirror.
Yeah.
But I can see he's got problems. Well. Right? We need to pray right now. Do we have an altar call right now in the middle of the service?
Preach it.
Verse 5. Well, God's got a plan, but verse 5 says, for all people will walk, everyone, in the name of their God, the name of his God. We will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. In that day, saith the Lord, listen to this. You ready? Look at this. Watch this. I love this. In that day, saith the Lord, will I assemble her that halteth. And I will gather her that is driven out, and her that I have afflicted. And I will make her that halted a remnant, and her that was cast off a strong nation. Can I tell you something? Not just is there the plan of God, but there's the peace of God.
Yeah.
But where do you see that? He's going to assemble that which is halted. He fixes what is broken.
That's right.
Amen.
And nothing brings peace than broken is being fixed. What was it about the millennial did he want them to know? Of all that has been prophesied, what is he prioritizing here? Peace.
Amen.
Peace. Of all the things, we could spend all week just studying the millennial, and all we would do is cover the name. I mean, you know, I mean, it's a 1,000 years. Talk about Christ's reign on earth and all that transpired to get us to that point. And then we could study all what's coming next. And the one thing that Micah was trying to get into their hearts and minds about this coming period, the coming part of his plan, is that there won't be any more brokenness. There won't be any more fighting.
Right.
There won't be any more places where we can't find rest. He's promising his peace. The fighting had stopped. Can I tell you, he stops fighting, no one else can stop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this violence on the street, nobody can fix that. But you know what he does? He puts a church right here.
Yeah, I know.
That plays the Clark Family music playing outside. We pulled up and we said our neighbors would probably kill us if we did that.
Right.
We had that going before the service, right? They'd have a petition. We'd be in the news.
Right.
No lie, right? In Bridesburg, that's how they roll. You know, we'd probably have our power cut off. We'd have, you know, it'd be nuts. We fight over things. We fight over differences, skin, background, and race. We fight over locations. You know, America has been at war 93% of the time. 222 out of 239 years, America has been at war.
Wow.
With one thing or another. Of the past 3,400 years of human history, humans have been entirely at peace for 268 days, or 268 years. 8% of recorded history has there been a time when there's been no fighting somewhere.
Wow.
And that's not even mentioned in homes.
Yeah.
Right? Anybody have more than one kid? We have two. We only have two. It's a boy and a girl. And it's no joke. I just get tired of hearing it. You know, we went to a stage where like there was like one day where like, wow, the kids are really getting along. Oh, this is great. We got like the best kids ever. And then they spoil us.
Yeah.
And he was born. And then it was over. We took a trip a few years ago. We drove about 8 hours. We drove for a speaking engagement in Ohio. And we had one of those vans with the stow-and-go seats, you know. And we put my daughter or son, somebody was in the middle row. And someone was in the back row. And that was the best trip ever. Because we didn't let them see each other.
Yeah.
You know? Here's some devices and headphones. Here's Connect. Watch a couple movies, you know. Gave him some special juice, Benadryl. Gave some of my wife while I was at it. Good juice, good juice, good juice. At least 108 million people were killed in wars in the 20th century. Estimates for the total number killed in wars through all of human history range from 150 million to 1 billion people. And God says, I'll give you peace. Peace isn't something that we can figure out ourselves, by the way.
No.
Jesus gives peace.
Yeah.
Philippians chapter 4, verse 7 says, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You know what I've learned? In most situations as a pastor, when I go to a family that's broken and there's a need, you know what I see most of all? The need is peace. That's what I try to deliver. I try to bring Christ to that situation. Because a lot of times I can't resolve the situation. But I can help pray for peace. Peace is the solution. Peace is what we're craving. In crisis, we want peace. I want to make peace. Micah chapter 4, verses 7 to 10. And I will make her that halted a remnant, and her that was cast off a strong nation, and the Lord shall reign over them in Mount Zion from henceforth, even forever. And thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion, unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion. The kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. Look at verse 9. I like verse 9. Now, why dost thou cry out loud? Is there no king in thee? Is thy counselor perished? For pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. Be in pain and labor to bring forth, O daughter of Zion, like a woman in travail. For now shalt thou go forth out of the city, and thou shalt dwell in the field, and thou shalt go even unto Babylon. There shalt thou be delivered. There the Lord shall redeem thee from the hand of thine enemies. Look at verse 9. Now why dost thou cry aloud? Cry out loud. Is there no king in thee? Is thy counselor perished? You know, years ago I heard a message from a famous preacher. Then he preached the message, is there no king in thee? And he had said that the idea of this, he preached to young people and said, isn't there no royalty in you? Isn't there anything in you that, and you know, sometimes I wonder if a preacher's mind, you know, context get in the way of a good story or a good truth. And this message was preached to kind of look and say, you don't have royal blood. Why don't you have that royalty? You have Christ living inside you. But that's not what this context is saying. See, what had happened was, as this nation was under siege, and as this nation was being torn apart, their king, King Zedekiah, and many of the princes had been taken captive some years before the rest of the nation. That's what Babylon would do. Babylon didn't really intend, I don't know that necessarily they really cared to come in and wipe them out completely. They went and they took their king, and they took some of their princes, and they left them without leadership. And then they would send in some of their own kind of puppet leaders, and as long as people were paying their taxes, Babylon was pretty much okay with that, because they were subservient. The problem with Babylon with that is we had some leaders in Israel that said, well, we're not going to pay. And Babylon had to come back. But this is what's going on. They're saying all is lost because our king is gone. And I, you know what's amazing? God is sarcastic. He is. He loves Philly people because we're sarcastic, aren't we? How many people here are pretty, or you know someone that's sarcastic? You know, someone said this, I read it this week, I think Friday was National Slack Your Annoying Coworker Day, right? So it said, if you don't know who that is, stay home. You're like, if you don't know who it is, it's you. Right?
Oh my.
Uh-oh. Oh no. The truth of the matter is, God's sarcastic. You know what God's saying? Oh, really? You don't have a king? Your king's not around? Your counselors, the princes? You know, the secretaries of state and maybe the mayor and the city councilmen, they've all been taken captive. So now all of a sudden you're lost. God's saying, hello.
Right.
Hello. Yeah, I'm not going anywhere.
Yeah.
Amen.
Why did you turn to me? You know, God led Israel just fine before King Saul came around.
Yeah, that's it.
You remember that? You remember, you know church history, not church history, Israel history a little bit, Old Testament. You know a little bit, right? You know that God did well before Saul came around.
Yeah.
I remember he said, Samuel, go tell the people, they're going to have problems with the king.
Yeah.
And now the king is gone. And he's saying, wait a minute, you don't get it. You don't get it. When we go through a crisis, you know we need to realize that God's with us.
Right.
Amen.
All along, God never forsook them.
Right.
But in fact, when they were in Babylon, guess what? They were delivered by God's hand. God took him to Babylon to deliver them. He was with them even in Babylon. You know why? Because God never leaves us. Never. It's against his nature, against his character. He can't even physically do it. Because he's everywhere. Do you understand that when we go through crisis, we need to celebrate the presence of God?
Yeah.
See, we saw that God has a plan. We saw that God offers peace. But we also have to be persuaded that God's never left us. And sometimes, listen, you ready for this? You ready? Sometimes God does some chop work in our life to separate us from the things that we're holding on to that we think are supporting us.
Yeah.
So we can see it wasn't that all along. You know what Israel had to say? Zedekiah couldn't deliver us. Zedekiah couldn't turn back the tide. Even a king couldn't save them. Can I tell you something? End of this week, we'll have a new president. I don't know who you voted for. I don't know if your side won or lost. If you're loving on what's going on, or you're just kind of like, what in the world is going on? But my hope is not in the president.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I tell you something, my hope is not in someone who can have a heart attack and die.
That's right.
My hope is not in someone who can't really affect any change. We think, if your hope's in a man that's taking office next week, you're broken.
Yeah.
You don't get it. God's bigger than all of that.
Yeah.
And you know what we hear all the time? Well, you know, this and that, and this is our hope. You know, I think this president may give us a little bit more time to have another chance.
Amen.
But that's all he's given us.
Yeah.
He's not going to solve all these problems. Jesus is the one that solves these problems.
Amen.
The peace that he provides solves these problems. The presence of God. So go ahead. Go trouble. Go experience his trouble. And just say, I'm all alone. Sometimes we go through problems and we say, there's no one to help me. No one called me. No one lifted me up. No one loves me. That's what you needed to survive. You needed the call of a friend to make it through. What about the very presence of God that's with you? God's leading them into this purging. But he doesn't leave them there. No, he still is their king. He is their counselor. Every crisis is God-controlled.
Right.
He is reigning in your life. But for us, it's about a lack of control. See, if they go to Babylon, they don't have control. A crisis is, I can't fix it.
Yeah.
A crisis is beyond what you can repair. But sometimes God brings us through that crisis so that only he can fix it. He's tired of you fixing it. There's just sometimes that duct tape won't work. You know, if it's supposed to move and it doesn't, WD-40.
Yeah.
If it does move and it's not supposed to, duct tape. Some of us live life that way. I'm not talking about, you know, if you took your car to the shop and you had a flat tire, and he's like, go get that duct tape, Daryl, go get that duct tape. When Daryl turned around, so was I. I'm rolling out of that place. Sometimes God does some things, let us know that he's in control.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. Verses 11 to 13, as we'll close. Now also many nations are gathered against thee that say, let her be defiled. And let our eye look upon Zion. You know what they're looking on and saying? You know what? Let them be taken captive. The nation, let them fall. We want to see that. But look at verse number 12. Again, I like the word but. But they know not the thoughts of the Lord.
That's it.
Well, that's a great thing to underline. Sometimes we don't know the thoughts of the Lord. Neither understand they his counsel. For he shall gather them as the sheaves unto the floor. He's going to take care of that. Look at verse number 13. Arise and thresh, O daughter of Zion, for I will make thine horn iron, and I will make thy hoofs brass, and thou shalt beat in pieces many people, and I will consecrate their grain, their gain unto the Lord, and their substance unto the Lord of the whole earth. Hey, when we're in crisis, we need to remember that God's got a plan. When we're in crisis, we need to be persuaded that God offers peace. When we're in crisis, we need to celebrate that God's presence is with us. When we're in crisis, we need to understand something. We need to get a hold of the power of God. We need to get a hold of the power of God. God is doing something.
Yeah.
He's always doing something.
Yeah.
In verses 11 and 12, when all their enemies are coming around and saying, oh yeah, that's Adam, that's Apollo, it's good for them. Let's see them suffer. Let's see God's people go through this. God's working.
Yes, he is.
He's not taking a break.
No.
That's right.
He's not taking a breather. He didn't call a timeout.
Right.
He's in the game.
That's right.
He's working. He's setting up their deliverance. And then in verse 13, it says, arise, arise and thresh. The idea here is to arise out of their weakened state and take care of their enemies who God has weakened. Get up and take care of business is what God's saying.
Okay.
He says, I will make thine horn iron, thy hoofs brass. He is strengthening them beyond their own strength. Because we don't have that type of strength in and of ourselves, do we?
That's right. Amen.
A horn's not made out of iron. Hoofs aren't made out of brass. Man, a hoof is a sensitive thing to an animal. But God says, I'm going to strengthen you in a way that you've never been strengthened before.
Amen.
The application is here that they're being prodded to rise up and conquer in His strength. But listen, brokenness comes. Problems come. You might say, maybe you've been spared that. That's probably not the general experience of the people in this room. Problems, bills, health, life-altering decisions, life-altering problems, accidents, separation. And nothing hurts, man. As a pastor, I feel for people. What's it like to be a pastor? Is you get to feel what your whole church feels. It's not just getting up here and preach. I go through. If it doesn't even happen to me, I still hurt. I've got a family in our church. They're hurt. A wife who's been separate from her husband. Her husband left. Babies at Christmas this year. Split hounds. It's broken. A woman sitting there saying, no one loves me. Health issue coming up, and a man in our church has been diagnosed with Parkinson's. Can't really function as he used to. It's brokenness. Got two people that come to our church that are homeless. Like, not just start coming because they're homeless, but they've been there a while and they're homeless. That bothers me. That hurts me. I need to be reminded. I go through my own problems, my own hurts, my own insufficiencies. And I need to be reminded that God's got a plan. God's plan isn't just short-sighted, it's eternal. I need to share and convey that God offers peace. To lock on that God's with me, God's with them, and you're not alone. But then to remind them that this isn't something that, your boat's not a little boat that's just getting beat up by the waves.
Right.
You're attached to the King of Kings.
Yeah, right.
That ocean seems dark. That ocean seems boisterous. But God's in control.
Yes, he is.
And they needed to be reminded. Hey, listen, I got some bad news for you. Things are going to be rough. But God's got plans beyond that.
That's right.
And those plans are peaceful plans. Listen, I just keep repeating these points over and over again. I'm hoping you'll get it.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not going to leave you. His presence is with you. And by the way, with God, nothing shall be impossible.
That's right. Yeah.
Maybe you'd be challenged tonight. Maybe you're going to go through something this week, and this is what you needed to hear. Maybe this has been your life story. Storms? Yeah, that's the norm.
All right.
Maybe there's something that's just rocking your boat and you just, maybe it's something that happened years ago and you just can't get over it. You might look like on the outside you're over it, but you know what I'm talking about. There's something on that inside you just can't get peace with. And it bugs you. It rubs you the wrong way. Maybe you were hurt. Maybe you let people down. Maybe everything got turned upside down. Whatever it is. It's a crisis. God says, when you cry out to me, these are the things I want to remind you of. So what are our points? You ready? Here we go. We're just going to say, you ready? God's plan. All right, let's try it again. God's
plan.
All right? God's
peace.
All right? So God's plan, God's peace, God's
presence,
God's
power.
Now we're going to do it all together. You ready? Here we go. Take a deep breath. God's
plan,
God's peace, God's presence, God's power. You guys are looking like, I don't want to mess it up. And I was thinking, I don't want to mess it up. God wants us to see that when we're going through it. These are the reminders. And is that a faithful interpretation of Micah 4?
Amen.
Sometimes you read through these and you don't really know what it's saying, but this is a gold
one. Yeah, amen.
Micah is a gold one. Man, go through it. I'll tell you what, you'll be persuaded. Even though God's dealing with us, He's got this.
Yeah.
He's got this. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. Maybe tonight you just need to remind that God's in control. Maybe tonight there's a problem. You